I don't know about you, but I am really enjoying what I'm hearing tonight from Tony Kosinec. He's my guest this evening. We're talking about, let me see if I can do this right, the Kabbalah. And this is an incredibly beautiful system that I'm hearing about here. And again, it brings up an old question that I have had for the longest time. And maybe my question here is naive. It might be. But, you know, like I said, throughout my own teachings, so in my own life, this comes up. The Kabbalah, it comes up. It's constantly referenced and talked about, probably incorrectly most of the time. But yet there's this hatred of Jews that I've heard about all my life growing up. I've heard about this. And people, there's Jew jokes and there's Polish people jokes. And I just don't understand it. If this predates the Torah, if this predates the Jewish system of belief, it just doesn't make any sense to me why there would be this antisemitism, this hatred of Jews. Tony, welcome back to the program. Maybe you can help me out with this, because listen, every Jewish person I've ever met in my life, I mean, these are the salt of the earth people. I can't find, if I tried, a reason to hate the Jewish people. What is going on with that?
Well, first of all, you're brave to ask that question, okay? I know I brought it up, but you didn't have to pick it up. We are a single creature. The way we understand that in modern science is that we're a system.
Mm-hmm.
And we are completely dependent on each other, and we're being evolved as a single creature. Now, we need organization. We need to be able to feel the type of sense of direction, impulses that allow us to grow, just like any plant has some kind of a DNA that allows it to take a certain form and to reach some intention that nature has for its shape and mm-hmm. its quality and so on.
Mm-hmm.
So when you think about humanity as a system or as an organism, there is a quality, say, there's a quality of the heart, there's a quality that's the hand, there's a quality that is the nose, there's a quality that is the head, and so on. Now, as I said, the people who followed Abraham had nothing in common other than the ideology to function as a completely integrated society that would reflect the law, the primal law of nature. That's what it was about. It wasn't, they were not a race, not an ethnicity. They weren't even from the same cultures. They all came from the 70 nations of that time. What united them was the desire to reach this spiritual quality, which is the same intention of bestowal that is how the force of nature works and how it evolves us. That's it. And as long as we have that in our system, mm-hmm. we safely evolve. The system does not break down. It stays in balance. It can grow. It can expand. You can have, as we've had in the past, you can have empires and all of these things. Well, maybe today we can't anymore. We've expanded to the ends of the world, and now we have to learn to live with each other. But the system of humanity, or the system of the cosmos itself, needs this. So when it's not happening, the system feels it. And people feel, just like you say about Kabbalah, people say, well, that's where this came from, and it's true. Many of these things of our understanding of science, even modern science, originates in things that you will find in the Zohar and all of that stuff. People feel, whether they know it or they've learned it, they feel innately, systemically, whether there is a head that is actually managing the system, connecting all of the nodes in the system in the most efficient, productive, beneficial way or not. Mm. Now, when we lost our connection to the upper force, mm-hmm. and people were scattered all over the world from ancient Israel, They had experienced that, but they were no longer able to do it. And all of humanity fell into a kind of a dark age. Dark only in the sense that we were unable to sort of transmit the light from the highest forces of nature for the benefit of the whole system. Mm-hmm. People feel whether that's happening or not. And they feel rightly that that portion of us that had that job isn't doing the job. They know, they feel, and this is how it happens on the human feeling level, emotional level, they feel that the Jews, in other words, the Kabbalists, are withholding from us that thing that we need to have successful societies.
Oh, my God. Really? Is that the thing? Is that it?
Yeah.
Oh,
it's like
God.
An alarm that goes off within human society worldwide when we are not able to do that. And it's only because we're late. First of all, those people from the 70 nations that we call Jews have to learn and have to teach this method of uniting humanity, especially now that we're up against real crises. All of our institutions don't work anymore because we're not united for the right reason. So there is a rightful claim. There's a rightful claim, but it has nothing to do with that. People say, well, they're stealing or they're dishonest or this or that. No. People don't even understand why they feel it. They feel the system is in trouble. That steering mechanism or that channel that's for the benefit of everybody is not functioning well enough, and they're demanding it because the system is somewhat in danger. Now, that's good. Because it ends up waking up that part of humanity to the point that it will actually take care of that function in the system.
Mm.
And today, that function is to learn and to teach this method of uniting humanity.
Okay, well, that's all well and good. But it just seems like a heavy load to put on the shoulders of one group of people on this earth. I mean, we all live here. We're all on spaceship Earth. Why put the blame on one group of people on Earth? Oh, the Jews know the answer, and they're not telling us. I mean, if people actually get mad about that, then we've got bigger problems.
It's not because we're one thing, you know. When your leg hurts, your head has to take care of it. It's not one people. Think of it as a strata of, or you know, like functions in a body or organs in a body. It's just like we've got a sluggish liver. You know what I mean? It's like it's not doing the job, and it isn't anybody's fault. That's how nature evolves systems. It always puts pressure on things in order to create new possibilities and for us to leap to new levels. And we call this section of our creature Jews, and we make all kinds of associations with it, but Jews are us and we are Jews, and it's just like our system is not working right. We want that part of the system to work. The fact that it happens intrinsically is just how nature works with us. It's nobody's fault. I really hate it. I personally am Jewish, and it's my parents went through the Holocaust and all of that stuff. But we have to understand that everything, remember the thought of creation, to create a creature and to bring it to complete fulfillment.
Yes.
That's how it does it. And no matter how things appear, it's doing that in order to evolve us to a better and better state.
Through a need.
Yes.
And the need at this time, being that we are not connected, and there's now, when you were explaining about, so they sense that the system isn't working right. Is this just humanity in general? We all kind of sense that the system isn't working right, and this manifests in different ways, such as some of the things that we see nowadays, what with institutions not working right, with people being so polarized. Is that how the need manifests?
Yes. Because when you think about the intractable separation that we're having, what need would you say is being evoked in humanity as a whole because of that?
The need for connection.
Yeah.
The need to listen to each other.
Yes, and it probably will not be a shallow type of connection, because we also have this accompanying feeling that, oh my goodness, we're going to destroy ourselves, you know. We're going to ruin the ecosystem and all of that. I mean, we feel this fear, but it's a good fear, because it's pushing us towards our next step, which is being united for the sake of the entire system. Mm-hmm. And we wouldn't be able to get there if there wasn't that sort of jeopardy. That's how things evolve everywhere.
Now, this I can understand. This I can absolutely understand. But I don't think I'll ever understand anti-Semitism. I think that is probably beyond me. I've just never in my entire life found any reason to not just absolutely be delighted by the Jewish people. I mean, every guest that I've had come on, Jewish guests that come on, they're incredibly well-versed in whatever they're going to talk about. I mean, these people are very generous. I will never understand it. Okay. So we've got a need, and it's pretty clear. And we've got this beautiful system that started to be revealed in 1995, like mm-hmm. you said. Now, is there still this push among Kabbalists to get this knowledge out there today, right now, in 2018?
Actually, it was up until 1995, it was purposely hidden. Mm-hmm. And afterwards, the group of Kabbalists that I work with are working day and night in order to do this. Some don't. Some are still in the tradition. Actually, things really changed in around 1500. That's when humanity began to be able to do something about it, of our condition. It changed there. The sort of the exile, what we call the exile from spirituality, began to end then. Mm. But in 1995, it was completely done. And we could begin to reveal this because it could be felt and understood, because there was a need for it. And people wouldn't think, well, it's mysticism, or it's about angels and demons and all of these kinds of things that are really only states within the human intentional level. There's nothing objective about those things at all. That humanity would begin to understand and be able to make use of it. Now, to me, this show, and I've listened to this show for a very long time when Art, was the guy, and I really enjoyed it, and I love hearing how people are understanding their situations and the explanations they're trying to give for it. Now, you can see that you are grasping. I know, I can feel you, and you're grasping this on exactly its terms. I know there are other things around it, but you are. And up until last week, there was no way in the world that there would be an opening for Kabbalah to come to your audience, at least not in this form. There's a lot of masquerading forms, mm-hmm. but not the real science. So the fact that this is happening is an indication of a stage that we've all reached together, where we can begin to look at our situation, our life, the goal of life, and so on, in a kind of pragmatic, scientific way, and we're going to be able to progress like this.
Well, I sure hope so. Again, it seems like this is what is needed, and it's interesting to hear you say that, because for, I don't know, the last couple of months, maybe three, I keep asking and I keep sort of marveling at how insane the world is going around us, and I keep asking, what is the solution? What is it that's missing? What is it? And then here you are, almost like nature is answering that question by putting Tony Kosinec right in front of us and saying, well, okay, here you go. Maybe this is something that's needed. And if it is all done through a need, then are we practicing Kabbalah right now?
Yes.
By having this conversation?
Yes, we are. We are in an essential way, like in its sort of microcosm. Mm-hmm. The way that you and I are feeling each other and establishing a something for the benefit of your audience and is that process. But our problem with what we have to attain now is how do we maintain it?
Yes.
You know, we have lots of insights that people have, and we get all kinds of awakenings, even as individuals, and those awakenings are meant to bring us closer and closer to what's how we're being evolved. But we can't hold on to them because we require we have to see it in others. We have to build things with each other so that we reflect back to each other that this is really so. Mm-hmm. That there is something beyond what we call human nature, which is selfish and so on. It's good. It's supposed to be like that. It's not a limitation. It's a tool. But we need to see this effort happening from other people. And that's the kind of thing that needs to be built. Now, I want to tell you that, like I told you, said, how do you do it? What's the method? People need to learn basic fundamentals that change slowly, change the way that they perceive. And if they're interested, they go further. There's no coercion in this. You just do what you can according to your desire and according to how nature's working on you. But we've tried to make the entry to this as easy on people as possible. That's why we built the KabU, which starts out as a self-study thing where people can learn about the basic principles, and it will scramble your head. It'll straighten it right out, and you'll be able to see what's going on in the world and why that's happening. Mm. It does that for everybody, and it begins to change the way that you look at things. And if a person if their desire is building and they want to go further, they can, right up until the point where they want to work in a Kabbalistic 10 and all that stuff. Not everybody has to do it, but it's good for people to be exposed to the real principles on which life sort of is motivated, and they can do that on their own to whatever degree they want to do. There's a link on the website that will take people to KabU and just, you know, pick and choose. It's like it's a big buffet there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's no prescribed mystical secret, top secret, gotta know the secret handshake kind of way to get into this.
Not anymore.
Wow. Well, that's.
But there is something that you could call mystical. It's not mystical in the kind of transformation that happens in people and what they begin to value in life and how they begin to perceive.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, there's the magic right there. There's the magic that we're all after. Pardon an ignorant question. I think ignorant is the correct word. I simply don't know. Is there a connection here to Buddhism? Because some of the ideas sound quite similar. And I know these are cultures that were separate at the time. But their ideas seem to be kind of similar.
Well, they actually aren't separate. First, Kabbalah predates Buddhism.
Okay.
And yeah, and the people who there is this saying. Let's look at it first in a sociological way. There is this saying that Abraham gave gifts to all of his sons. In other words, the teaching went out to the to the existing world at that time, to civilization as it was, and was adapted culturally. Well, what does that mean? It means that nature functions in a certain way. You can interpret it all you want, and you can take as much of it as you want or not, but that's the way nature works.
Mm-hmm.
So you will see certain similarities. By the way, Brahman is just a reconfiguration of the word Abraham, which is kind of interesting thing.
I always wondered that, actually.
But they took different aspects of it. In the East, they took what Kabbalists call the right line, and what they do is they kind of detach from reality, not reality. They detach from culture, and they're looking for. The positive ascension. This is like one pole in how nature works. Things happen for people. They perceive all kinds of things, but there's one aspect of it that is not used, and that is the total interconnection. Now, people can, I'm not going to go into too much detail because I'm not looking for the differences. I'm really trying to show what the similarities are. Mm-hmm. So there is an inheritance of a certain part of the natural system and the science and how it works. And you'll find, say, in Islam, you'll find what we call the left line, which is takes a part of exactly that same. Sufism deals with a lot with the left and its integration with the right. Kabbalah deals with a middle line that connects all of those things together and leaves absolutely nothing out. It is like, as far as I know, it is the full system of nature. And I have been a seeker my whole life, and I've tried all of those things and have learned with people. And I came to this because I felt that it incorporated the whole thing. So they are concurrent. And not in the sense that they weren't all created at the same time, but they share actual forms from nature. But how many of them and to what degree, you know, people will have to tell me that.
Mm, all right. So, of course, they're similar because if a system is following the laws of nature, if it truly is following the laws of nature, then other systems who do the same are going to end up being a little bit similar because, well, they're all following the same laws, the laws of nature. And once you're following the laws of nature, well, those don't change. Those pretty well stay the same,
exactly.
You know, because, well, it's nature, and nature works in a particular way. So, okay, that makes some sense. Then let's get. Looks like we do have a break sneaking up on us here, Tony. Let's get more into the method, if we can. I mean, if there's another aspect of this that you think is more important for us to talk about, you know, feel free to say something. But now I'm at a point where I want to figure out how to start doing this, and what that involves. If you wouldn't mind, maybe when we come back from the break, we can talk about, because it seems like it's a journey. So what are the steps on the journey in the method? And again, pardon all my dumb questions that are about to come forth on all this, but I just really, truly want to understand it. And so far, like I've been saying, this it just sounds like a beautiful system, beautiful belief system. It's tied into the laws of nature, which aren't changed, and it deals with unity, wanting to bring people together to the point that the other person's needs are more important than your own. What could be more beautiful than that? This, I think, the world needs. Doesn't matter to me what kind of label it's under. It's going to come to us under. We need to get together. So let's figure out how to do that when we come back from the break with Tony Kosinec. An ancient science. An ancient, now, I might be saying this wrong here, but I'm starting to think of the Kabbalah as an ancient spiritual science. I'm sure my guest tonight, Tony Kosinec, can correct me on that if I'm wrong, but I want to head into the wormhole because I got so caught up in the conversation with Tony tonight, I haven't been to the wormhole all night long. So let's go and take a look and see what in the world are the people saying out there. So Aaron in Hawaii says, hey Heather, did your NDE experience match the description he just made about pleasure is equal to more than all the creatures have ever experienced all combined, i.e. the peace and ecstasy you had, was that equal to his description? Yes, I was thinking about that at the time. I thought, my God, these are some of the same teachings that I received in that experience. We'll go back to the wormhole here. Vaughn says, this might explain the barrage of materialism that is rampant in the world today and the invasive commercialism we are surrounded by. Are these the death throes of the lower forces trying to maintain control? Really interesting question that we'll pose to Tony. Also from Maker, my friend out there, Mr. Maker, he says, well, here we go on the biggest ride that can be taken. And then that just, you know, just sort of solidifies my idea that this was a good idea to bring this to the program tonight because, you know what, I didn't think about it a whole lot, and I didn't really hesitate at all. Producer Michelle asked me, well, what do you think about talking about the Kabbalah? And I went, yep, do it. And that was the end of that conversation. Because to me, if there is an ancient system that goes back as far as the Kabbalah does, then we need to be looking at that. We need to be looking at that. A system that would endure that many years. Well, there's a reason for it. It probably has something to offer all of us. And I have so many questions. It's really the challenge I'm running into tonight is staying focused, because we're talking about the Kabbalah is almost beyond the scope of one even long-form talk show. So we're doing our best to cram it all into the time that we have available to us tonight. But there really is a whole lot to this, and I'm finding it difficult to focus. And what I want to focus on now, welcome back, Tony. Welcome back to the program. What I'd like to focus on is this method. Now, I know at KabU, you can go in, you can kind of poke around and see what you like. But if I wanted the best first step to take, is that going to be a meditation? Is that going to be a text I need to read? Help me out here to set me on the right path, Tony.
The best place to go is to learn first, to learn the fundamentals. You know, one of the things that Kabbalah has an advantage in for speeding up the development of a person is the quality of its definitions. For instance, take spirituality.
Mm-hmm.
That, as far as modern thinking goes, there's actually no definition for that in practically any system. We sort of understand what it means. It's something above human nature. It's something free of limitations, something like that. But it's the very, in a sense, that word becomes the definition for vague. So the positive thing that a person gets from learning the fundamentals and the definitions is that it anchors them. So that's why it becomes the first part of a person's learning. It doesn't take that long to get it. Mm-hmm. It takes a couple of months to get the fundamentals. But what Kabbalah says spirituality is, as for an example, is that it is the intention to bestow. That's it. And that there's an absolute void between our nature and that intention. Our nature is the opposite intention. So what we're trying to do is find how do we invert our nature in some way to become like that. And when we do that, we are in touch with the upper force. That's a very clear and concise definition. Mm-hmm. So the first thing that people do is that they learn things that sort of that solidify, focus their understanding, and also in some ways flip the way in which they look at things. Because ultimately, we're trying to do that. We're trying to invert the way that we use reception. So after a person does that, they would go on to working with the correct texts, or they'll learn those fundamentals in connection with exposure to real, authentic texts.
Mm-hmm.
And for our generation, our point in human evolution, they involve the Zohar, which was written for this particular time in human evolution.
Mm-hmm.
And in order to understand what's in the Zohar or even how to study it, we learn from the texts of Isaac Luria, who wrote The Tree of Life, and the texts of Yehuda Ashlag, who is the preeminent Kabbalist of the 20th century, who did a commentary on both the Zohar and the Tree of Life. And then there's very, very special material by the student and son of Yehuda Ashlag, Baruch Ashlag, who wrote a whole bunch of articles and books that allow a person to understand the method and to get onto the first step of the spiritual ladder. Such a thing has never existed until around 1989. Until that time in human history, there was nothing that came down to the level of the the common person that would allow them to sort of dress in this whole thing and go, I get it. I understand what I'm supposed to be doing. Like spirituality all of a sudden It's not spirituality, so to speak. It is access to how nature operates. All of a sudden, it lines up in, and it tells us what sort of work we should be doing and how we should be doing it. Mm-hmm. So what happens after that is that a person, once they've done those things, they've exposed themselves to that material, they begin study on a regular basis. Now, that depends on the person. But it means that you start, it's like dyeing a cloth. Whatever you choose to do, I'll tell you what we do, we study every night for 3 hours, but that's not required of everybody. You're constantly putting your awareness into this common group of people who hold exactly the same goal as you do, and you know that anything that happens there is for the purpose of connecting with each other in this attainment. It's like art. Things start to happen. If you're focused on the right thing, if your friends are reinforcing your focus, and you can see that these people who you're learning with are constantly trying the best that they can to care for you, love you, and support you in the way that they're thinking. Imagine, what's it like to look into the eyes of a person when you go, well, what does he really, do they, you know, what are they really thinking? They probably hate me or what. But you're looking at a person and you're working with a person who, if they don't love you, you see the struggle in their eyes. You see that what they want more than anything is to care for your well-being. And you know you're doing that too. And just like the kind of conversation that you and I are having right now, mm-hmm. What gets established there is a completely different basis of relating. And that's where the transformation happens. So eventually people study together in groups and so on. It's kind of an ongoing thing. And the transformation that happens in people, the first one takes big transformation, huge transformation happens within about 6 months. Then there's an extended time where we begin to understand the importance and how to use unity between people. That takes a year or so. And then it becomes a kind of a way of life. And a person can, you know, do this as much as they want or not. But the byproduct, what we're trying to get out of this is a changed world. If a person feels themselves as, yo, that's what I was born for, I want to do that, I want to contribute that to humanity, then go for it. Then you're the right person for that job. But people only really need to know, basically, where we came from, why we're experiencing the things we are, and where we're going in the general sense, because the force of all of the people who are doing that eventually become the human community, and we carry each other. I don't know if I've really answered your question, but it's difficult to describe exactly what a person does because it's inner work. But a person is given a laboratory in which to experience the kinds of changes that actually bring them to a very different intention from where they started.
And then since you're working with a group of people in all of this, excuse me, I'm sorry, since you're working with a group of people, then do you then get to see their transformations and their experiences through all of this as they learn? And do the other students then get to learn from each other, watching each other go through this thing?
Yeah, that's exactly it. That's what family does for each other.
Yeah.
You see it. You know, you see your brother or your sister growing up. You know, you see them achieving things. You become jealous of them in a good way. and you want to attain those things because you get a need for the right thing constantly, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you do. And you see people changing. You can feel the way that they're acting, how they speak. You can feel it in the quality of your own life. Nothing determines a person's fate or destiny more than the environment that they place themselves in.
Oh, you're so right about that. And the people that you're around, that are around you. Mm-hmm.
Yep, that because everything functions by law. So you come into this life with you know, a bunch of DNA and a bunch of things you've inherited, and they're not yours, and you feel them as though they're yours, but you know, you've inherited them all. Even your own desires aren't truly yours. So if you can plant that seed in a lot of different places, and according to the conditions of the farm in which you get planted, you're gonna be a healthy stalk of wheat, or you're gonna wither and what rot. So the thing is to find the best possible environment so that the things that nature gave you will come to fruition in the way that it was intended. If we go to someplace less than what we think is our best environment, we can't develop fully. So what, you know, what Kabbalists are trying to do is to create some kind of a learning environment that creates a mini society, like a, it's kind of like a flight simulator.
Okay.
That teaches a person how to do this. Like, this is where the controls are, these are the handles, and so on. And eventually, the whole point of this is not just to work in that little group, but to be able to influence the world, to be able to be a channel that that allows quick and positive and sustainable evolution for the whole system, to bring it out to the world, to treat everybody that way. But you can't start by treating everybody that way. A person must do it in the simulator and learn how to do it. It's like Kung Fu or something. You know, it's like you really have to learn the spiritual art.
Well,
and then you have a role in the world.
Yeah, well, it's a system that's been in place for, you know, what, 5,000-6,000 years, mm-hmm. and it's worked very well through 5,000 and 6,000 years. And so who are we to start changing things around in a system that has been working just fine for as long as it has? Mm-hmm. You know, I would say, yeah, if that's the system that's been in place for that many years, then follow the system as it exists, and there's a reason for the system of learning being the way that it is. I mean, this was all thought about by folks probably, you know, very familiar with all of this that came long before us. You know, they put the system in place and they understand how to teach people Kabbalah. And, you know, it just seems to me, well, let's see, 1995, I guess I did, well, my own studies, witchcraft studies, by the way, very, I guess a little different than what we're talking about tonight, but that
somewhat
was,
similar.
Well, we have some similar ideas. It's all meant to be for the good of everyone, for the good of mankind, all of it, and, you know, that was in the late 1997 through about, I don't know, 2001 or two or something like that. And I started to hear more about the Kabbalah, but there are so many things confused in it. I didn't hear any of the things you're explaining to me tonight.
No.
I heard about the Tree of Life, and I heard about number squares, and I heard about there's secret things that you can't learn, and codes, and this kind of a thing. I didn't hear anything about these beautiful ideas you're telling us tonight about unity and actually experiencing the other person's needs in such an intimate way. This I'm not familiar with at all. I don't think any... Well, I can't say that. I was about to say I don't think any of us truly understand it, but I'm sure there are some that do.
You know, the stuff about secrets, they say about the Zohar, you know, that that the secret of the Zohar is locked behind 1,000 locked doors. Actually, it's not locked at all. It really depends on what a person wants. But one of the reasons that you haven't heard this stuff about Kabbalah is because the books of Kabbalah, including the Torah, is written not like people think. You know, it's not like a mathematical code, though. Even though everything is holographic and you would be able to see number relations and all of that. That's not what it's about. Everything in there it's written in a form that we call language of branches. It uses words from this world to refer to intentions and to refer to states of a person as they evolve in a ratio between the will to receive to the will to bestow. It's tracking the attainment of the human as they become more and more like the fundamental law of nature. So everything that it speaks, it's a transdimensional language that people cannot understand. They think that it's speaking about the physical world because there are no words on the level of intention. So it must use the general language And it was always intended to indicate to people who already had attainment certain things about intentions and how they can grow and how they can how this force of nature works and so on. It's always describing those types of things, but it has been uniformly misunderstood and materialized in people's thought. It's not their fault. It's because it wasn't – it was intended to be kept this way until the evolution of the ego ended, and that ended in 1995. My friend and I like to say that's the year the world ended, that because it, we could no longer – we were evolving in a very positive way. We needed to evolve that way up until that point only by means of one of the forces, the egoistic force. That's why we had the kind of wars that we had and why we have the aggression and why we have the types of economies that are not based on trust or and all of these things. But that ended, and we've been trying to push beyond 1995 and make those institutions that are based on egoism work. We try to resurrect them, make them great again, and I have nothing – I'm not –
I know.
I'm not criticizing your president. He's serving a good purpose, but you can't do that because it no longer works, and we all feel that it doesn't work. Mm-hmm. We're already in a post-material state in which we have to learn to live in what we call spirituality. So that 1995 is a turnover point. Our hearts were open to the quality of life because we could no longer go with the quantity of life.
Mm-hmm. And so now this is why we feel a little bit lost, because we've let yes. something go, and we know we're supposed to grab onto something. We just don't quite know what it is, and we don't know where to find it.
That's right. We find it in each other.
Yeah.
And what we require is we need this sort of integral education. People need to understand where they are. Once people do understand that this is purposeful, that this is happening for a reason, it's supposed to happen, and we're not going to our doom. We're going to our next better state, a much more evolved, much more integrated, much more enlightened state that's going to be really productive for us. And we have to be now in this limbo in order to fully let go of the things that don't work and begin to truly desire the things that will work. If we, after this passage, it will start to crystallize for us.
Oh.
And that's why we're trying to, the Kabbalists are now trying to put as much understanding into what nature is as possible to help sort of build a bridge here.
Oh, man, I guess I didn't really realize how important this is. This is very important to all of us right now.
It's about building civilization on the proper basis.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and what are we all trying to maintain here? What do we all get up in the morning to participate in? Civilization. Mm-hmm. Again, this may sound like a strange question to you, but you say we are to get what we need from each other, by understanding each other. How is that done? I mean, if I know you and I get to know you and I get to know your needs and your hates and all of it, how does that help me?
I want to make it clear. I think you understand this. I get it from what you're saying. But I want to make clear to all our friends that are listening that we're not talking about solving problems on the physical level first.
Right.
Because everything in this world is called a world of outcomes. Everything that happens here is the result of an upper force, of an intentional force. And we are involved with that level, but unfortunately, unconsciously. We cannot fix our problems from this level at all. It's too late. This is not where things change. Things will be structured by the perfect crystalline form of the intention behind all of nature if we get out of the way by having an attitude towards each other that is equivalent in form to the attitude that is building everything. So what that does for us is what we try to do is to, in a sense, kind of not worry at all about what it is that we're getting or we're not getting.
Okay.
We are only concentrate or even what we give other people, because we can't help them that way by making an act first. A spiritual act always starts with, for whom am I doing this? Not just for the person, but I mean, like, ultimately, am I doing it to fulfill what nature wants from me? Let's say, what the Creator wants from me. If I'm fulfilling my friend, or even thinking that I want to fulfill my friend for that end reason, which is the beginning of everything, then the channel is completely open. In other words, all of the genius of the thought behind nature, the godliness, so to speak, will come into my friends, and you who do that will get a double portion of that.
I see. Okay. That I'm again kind of glad that we have a break to take here, because that I do want to absorb and then make sure that I really understood what you said. And I can hardly believe it. It's just about time to open up the phone lines, everybody. So I bet you have a lot of questions out there. I'm more than happy to take them. When we come back from the break, we'll open up the phone lines, everybody. And I'm really curious to know what you're thinking about all of this.